Welcome back to Open Source Summit North America 2025. My name is Paul Nashawaty and I'm covering the app dev space and all things open source. I'm joined today, how you doing?
I'm doing great, nice to be here.
Yeah, great to have you here. So let's talk about, you know, a lot of different things. We're talking about you know, free classes, we're talking about the CRA, we're talking about educational frameworks, how it helps employers. Mm-hmm. What is your take on this?
Yeah, so I work with the OpenSSF, the Open Source Security Foundation, and we're a collection of groups, large companies, academic researchers, governments, where we're focused on improving open source security and supply chain security for everybody. And everybody is a subset. Europe is part of that subset, and they just recently released a new law called the Cyber Resilience Act that is going to have some pretty far-reaching consequences across the whole globe, honestly, and the tech ecosystem especially.
Yeah, I absolutely know that it's a big part of some of the challenges that organizations are running into. We see that reporting coming out in September 2026, mm-hmm. and then everything has to comply by December 2027.
Exactly.
It's coming up faster than people think.
Mm-hmm.
So let's jump right into this, because okay. you know, when we think about these new compliances, these regulations, mm-hmm. a lot of times organizations will think about it in the context of, this only impacts me. Here in my little world, my microcosm of the world. Mm-hmm. And in reality, that's not true, especially when we talk about software.
Yes.
Right, talk about, we're a global environment, mm-hmm. we interact with global data, we interact with global requirements,
yes,
right?
Yes, we do.
So, let's start there.
Okay.
And figure out where we go.
And CRA is getting a lot of headlines right now, but from my perspective, I've been doing cybersecurity for 30 or so years, and there's nothing new in the CRA. This is all things that back when I was at a bank, I was at an insurance company, these are rules we had to follow already. There's some newer concepts like software bill of materials, but really this is something that cybersecurity people are very familiar with. Now, upstream open source developers, this is not necessarily anything they've ever had any exposure to, so that's where there's a lot of fear, uncertainty, and doubt from that community. But you know, part of our mission of our foundation and other foundations is we're trying to provide education and awareness. This is what the facts of the law are. This is what actions you're going to need to take. But really, the burden of the compliance falls on manufacturers. And you know, looking at the global economy, Europe is the third largest market
sure.
on the planet.
Yeah.
Every major manufacturer wants to be there, wants to sell their products. And
right.
if you are not CRA compliant, if you don't get that CE mark when they start issuing those in 2027, you're not going to be able to sell. So you've closed yourself off to a potential large base of customers. So you need to be aware, even though you might not live there.
No, that's absolutely a good point. I mean, when we think about how organizations are, it really is starting to expand. As I mentioned, I cover application development,
mm-hmm.
right? And I talk to many organizations about what their challenges are, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the challenge that the number one challenge that CIOs tell me is we need to modernize our applications,
yep.
right? And you know, they have their past heritage environment, they need to bridge the gap between the old and new, right? And bringing these things together, whether they're working with a net new application or if they're using their heritage applications, mm-hmm. these compliance and these rules still apply.
Absolutely.
Right.
And that's the CRA makes that extremely clear.
Right.
If you are selling a product as of this date, they don't care that you base this off of a RackAF mainframe app that's 30 years old. You need to patch it and keep it up to date and support your customers.
Absolutely, and you know, and that opens up vulnerabilities if you don't.
Yes.
But this is not just about the European law, right?
Right?
I mean, this is the impact is the global impact of data,
mm-hmm.
right? Because, you know, whether you're talking about the CRA for the EU, or you're talking about, executive orders that may have come mm-hmm. in place in North America,
mm-hmm.
or India doing their own thing.
Correct.
Let's kind of talk a little bit about mm-hmm. that, because it's an education that I think that the market needs to understand that this is not a monolithic site, you know, like site-specific thing. This
Correct.
Is a big, big issue.
And that's where my background helped make me very uniquely positioned to help out with this particular problem. I worked at a super regional bank during the housing crisis, and we had a lot of different regulators and compliance regimes we had to adhere to. And my team was responsible for all of it, and we didn't know that a server had to be PCI compliant or had to be SOX compliant or GLBA. So what our methodology was is we went for the strictest compliance regime and we implemented that across the board. Doesn't matter if it was managing the cafeteria menu or if it managed the online banking system. It
yep.
all held the same standard. And that's what we came into with the CRA, looking at the requirements. I'm like, oh, these are things, I had to do this 20 years ago back at the bank. They wanted this type of stuff.
Sure.
It had a different name. It wasn't secure by design, but it was the same kind of principles. It was all software development lifecycle. And so what we did is we have a project called the Open Source Security Project Baseline, where we went down and we mapped out 41 controls. And these are things, we have 41 controls broken up over 3 levels of maturity. And the first level of maturity we think is very reasonable that a single maintainer project should be able to achieve this with a minimum amount of additional effort. Because it's predominantly documentation tasks. Do you have a policy on contributions? Do you have a security policy? So there's a lot of really kind of quick and easy wins that we can provide templates and guides to help coach people through that. But then we took the baseline, so we have all these requirements. And then I went horizontally looking at different compliance regimes. So I started with the CRA. If a project follows the baseline, there are roughly 21 core cyber requirements for the CRA. If you follow the baseline, your project does, you covered 19 of them.
Yeah.
I can't help you out with protection of customer data.
Sure.
And there's a concept from GDPR about allowing an EU citizen to be able to be forgotten by a system. So I don't have anything around that. But everything else, all the hard cyber requirements, the baseline accounts for. Then I went through NIST cybersecurity framework, the software development, the SSDF, the software secure software development lifecycle. I actually was a contributor to that. And then we went through PCI, and we went through all these different compliance regimes to show you if one of the controls is for maintainers, you should use multi-factor authentication.
Right.
Because there's a lot of attacks directed towards maintainers, because if the attackers know if I get that commit bit, I own the software, I can start to introduce backdoors or malware, or just kind of corrupt things.
Sure.
So you introduce multi-factor, that makes that harder to achieve, and we tick it off. Well, great, you get CRA XYZ requirements, you get PCI ABC, you get CSF 123. And just to kind of show you how the utility of doing something once, it applies multiple times across multiple frameworks.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. You know, I will say though, that was a lot to unpack. You
know, I understand.
What you just said. And you know, when the audience here that may be watching our conversation mm-hmm. and talking about this, they may be coming at this from various stages. They could
right.
be very kind of early in their development and mm-hmm. understanding this to very, very, very mature mm-hmm. and understand it. When you think about this, I mean, I think what you're talking about with your experience and the frameworks you put into place, mm-hmm. it really helps benefit those employers and helps them understand what it is that they're trying to achieve, right?
Absolutely.
It also helps education of the market, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think maybe if we tell the audience here, what does that mean for educating the audience and like how can you help them, you know, become knowledgeable mm-hmm. if they're early in the stage of saying like, oh, are they already behind the eight ball? Or should they start now? Or are they going to be, you know, what's the revenue impact if they don't do these things?
Right.
Like, what's going to happen?
Yeah, and I have around education, I have a couple different angles here.
Okay.
First and foremost, like for the CRA in particular, we wrote a 90-minute course. So if you want to understand what the CRA is, what those obligations are, we have a free class you can take.
Okay.
I talk to developers, like as a developer, these are the impacts of this law for you, which, fun fact, developers don't have any obligations in the law, so yay. Unless you take money for your project. And then there's a really weird kind of nuanced space, but we cover that in the training. Then if you're a manufacturer, if I'm a vendor selling things, we tell the manufacturer, here are your obligations, here's how to learn more. Then, kind of thinking about all these different compliance regimes, again, we massage the baseline. Again, we wanted to make this simple. The value proposition for an upstream open source project using the baseline is ideally I'm reducing the noise from downstream. You're not going to have big banks or hyperscalers harassing you for an SBOM, harassing you for what's your policy, I need a fix. Ideally, if you follow the baseline, you have a path towards a less noisy future.
Okay. Okay.
But also, you know, you're improving the security qualities of your product. So
right.
you're increasing your eminence and renown. You're going to get more stars and likes. People are going to like and use your software more because they recognize you're doing the security things that I need.
Yeah.
Then from flip that over to a enterprise, a manufacturer perspective, the baseline's a checklist. This is a list of things that you should be doing in your own development practices, but also as you're selecting third-party components, I would like my third-party component to give me an SBOM. I'd like them to have security controls in their CI system. And I'm able to give them evidence to show that these projects have done that.
Yeah, you already have the RFP kind of built out, right?
Exactly.
So it's, that's really important to understand, especially when you're new to it, right? Mm-hmm. It's important to understand. Like, I'll also look at it in the context of the market landscape, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, this is a piece of the puzzle. It's not the puzzle.
Correct.
Right? So like, when we think about the market landscape, I know we kind of touched on it already a little bit, but I think it's important to kind of make sure we reiterate that there's a global impact. It's mm-hmm. not just an EU issue. However, this is driven by the EU.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean to you from as a global impact, and what does the market landscape look like?
From my perspective, and you'll see this in the US, where US generally, because it's very challenging to get laws passed, they'll work through procurement rules. And that's how you needed to have a NIST SSDF attestation, so you had to prove your software development practices to the government. You used to be able to have to show them SBOM. So we did requirements. So if you wanted to sell to the government, you had to do these things.
Okay.
And the CRA is going to be very similar. If you want to get into Europe, which again, it's a very lucrative market, there's a lot of potential profitability there. If you don't do these things, you're not in, you're closed out of that. And other nations around the world are thinking about similar things. We're aware that China and India both have versions of the CRA in flight. I believe the same things in Australia and Britain. So this is going to happen everywhere. So
yeah.
Even though it's not where you live today, it might be where you want to sell. Because again, we're a super connected world. Open source has helped kind of break down so many barriers. That you know, a developer in Africa, their product can be used at a huge multinational bank. It's amazing to kind of see this.
Yeah.
So it's everything can come from everywhere, and you need to understand that if you're doing core security right, you have unlocked those markets.
Well, and I think you kind of hit on a couple of other things too. Core security right, unlocking markets, but also addressing skill gap issues.
Yes.
Because if you're providing a blueprint,
mm-hmm.
right, it doesn't leave any room for kind of like what you should be doing. And the devils are in the details, right?
Yes.
If you're trying to get something done and you forget a checkbox, it's not like, oh well, I forgot a checkbox. It's like, you're not going to be able to be compliant.
Well, and there's also severe
consequences.
Absolutely.
So
for example, if your product is involved in a breach and you're found negligent or some EU citizen has been harmed by your product, like basically their data's stolen or whatever, the consequences are up to 2.5 times last year's total revenue of your company.
Yeah.
So it's for each infraction. So the consequences are huge.
Yeah, yeah.
But again, the profitability is that there's potentially you have a market. If you're showing that you make a robust, secure product that is done the right way, the potential for profits is amazing. And
yeah,
that connection.
And it can make or break a company.
Absolutely.
It can make or break a company.
Absolutely.
All right, so I know we talked a lot on this. Mm-hmm. Last word, what would you like the audience to know? Like, whether it's to get started or where they can learn more, what do you want the audience to know?
I would point the audience to that free CRA class if you care about this particular law.
Yep.
If you care about kind of core application security good practices and kind of understanding what a good project looks like, look at our security baseline. And then we also do a lot of education. We have a cybersecurity skills matrix, so if you want to get into either cybersecurity, application development, we have this matrix that breaks down 14 job families, and we say, in order to do these roles, these are the core cybersecurity skills you need to have and experiences you want to have. So again, if you're getting new into a career or you want to change careers, this is a nice blueprint to kind of show you where to go. On the flip side, for companies, it's also a blueprint for your HR team. These are the skills, these are the certifications and experiences we want. So again, we have a ton of resources. Almost everything is free and publicly available. And it's also if you have comments or feedback, you want changes, patches are always welcome.
Well, the audience heard it here first. They know where to go to get the information. I want to thank you for your time. Your insights have really been great. It's been awesome to have you on. I also want to thank the audience. My name is Paul Nashawaty, and I'm coming to you live from the show floor at the Open Source Summit at North America 2025. Thank you for watching theCUBE, the leading source of tech news.